I really congratulate the whole Meenakshi Laboratory for really taking forward knowledge of so many important aspects. So thank you again for making me a part of this. And of course, my special thanks to Dr. S. Padma for being a real colleague. So we'll be talking about a very, very important subject today. That's cervical cancer screening. And as I take you through the journey of cervical cancer screening, I think you'll understand why it's so important. So I bring you greetings from the land of Lord Jagannath. I'm from Orissa. So Puri is a very special place for all of us here. So I'll take you through a journey through the cervical cancer prevention and why it is important. For all my colleagues here, maybe gynecologist or not gynecologist, the cervical cancer is actually a problem, huge problem, and of public health importance. So I think we all are stakeholders, whether I'm a gynecologist or I'm a general practitioner, I'm a pathologist. So all are stakeholders in this cervical cancer prevention story. So as we understand, cervical cancer is an avoidable NCD because I'll remind you that it is a totally preventable cancer. Because it's caused by human papillomavirus, we have a vaccine for it, and it has a very long precancerous phase. So around 10 years from infection to a frank cancer, it takes around 10 years. So within this 10 years also, if we are not able to pick up this lesion, I think it should not be excused at all. So cervical cancer is very closely related to poverty. So here you can see that the dark blue areas, which are really in the southern Africa, where the human development index is very low. And you can see that the rates are very less in North America, where the human development index is high. And so India is in between. So, but the problem with India is that because of its huge population, we provide around 1/4 of the cervical cancers globally to the world. So here you can see that the projected number of cervical cancer deaths from 2018 to 2030 according to Human Development Index. So this has been shown that there will be a rise in the cervical cancer incidence, and it will be more in countries where the Human Development Index is low. So, and the projections are that indicate that there will be nearly 30% and 50% increases in cervical cancer deaths by 2030 and 2040 respectively. And low and medium HDI countries, especially regions where the burden is already the highest, like the Southeast Asian countries and Africa, will be the most affected. So I think so. That's why it's a huge problem and a problem thing of concern. So WHO urges all nations to pace up efforts. So WHO Director General, whom we have been seeing on the TV almost every day during the corona time, has also given this call for cervical cancer elimination. We can eliminate cervical cancer as a public health problem through intensified vaccination, because we know it's caused by HPV, which is a virus, human papilloma virus, like polio virus. So by intensified vaccination against HPV, screening and treatment. So it has to be a three-pronged attack for that. So the need, cervical cancer is a significant public health problem. HPV vaccine is a major breakthrough in preventive medicine. It also protects against many other cancers, including penile cancer, vulval cancer, and nasopharyngeal cancer. So organized screening program is not existent in resource poor countries, especially India. So that is why in FIGO, which was held in Rio recently, a declaration was given by WHO that elimination of cervical cancer has to be taken up as a priority. So here you can see that these are the propaganda data in which we saw that from 2008 to 2012 to 2018, the rates were slightly going down and down. So this is the global map. It shows that the low, where the human development indices are low, the cervical cancer rates are very high. So again, it's extrapolated that by 2030, the rates are going to rise, and more so in countries where the human development index is low, especially the African and the Asian countries. So WHO, that is why, urges us to pace up efforts, and it should be a three-pronged attack through intensified vaccination against HPV, screening for cervical cancer, and treatment. So the need, I've told, it's a cervical cancer is a significant public health problem. HPV vaccine is a major breakthrough in preventive medicine, and it protects against many other cancers. And in country like India, there is no organized screening program. So I think vaccine is going to be a big savior in the coming countries. So looking at this again, in FIGO declaration in Rio has been in sync with the WHO declaration that elimination of cervical cancer. So how do we do it? So just look, have a look at the Globocan data, which shows that from 2008 to 2018, the rates of new cervical cancer cases and deaths due to cervical cancer in India was slowly going down due to various reasons. We have no time to discuss that. But more recently, the Globocan 2020 has shown a steep rise again in the cervical cancer incidences and deaths due to cervical cancer. So I think it should be an alarm for all of us. So screening and analysis of the population-based surveys indicates that coverage of cervical cancer screening in developing countries is 19% only compared to 63% in developed countries. And this is, I think, a very important reason why the cervical cancer rates are low in those countries and ranges from 1% in Bangladesh to 73% in Brazil. However, older and poor women who are at the highest risk of developing cancer are least likely to undergo screening. So I think this is a very important thing we should remember. So looking at this again, so this is the photograph of George Papanicolaou, who was the father of cytology. So he developed the Pap smear. So George Papanicolaou developed the Pap test. In 1954, Dr. Papanicolaou published the Atlas of Exfoliative Cytology in 1940s. Cervical cancer was the number one killer of women then. But it was first introduced in the 1940s. National programs screening was established in 1988. But the screening program has to be backed by a program. It has to be a program. So opportunity screening in various regions of India varied from 6.9 to Kerala. In Kerala, which is quite high, to 0.006% to 0.002% in states like Maharashtra and southern state of Tamil Nadu. So I think this is again an important thing. But I think Tamil Nadu is now picking up very well. So most of the cases present in advanced and late stages, and more than half have regional disease at the time of presentation. So that's again a very important cause of concern. It's a preventable disease. We are not able to prevent it. And more than that, they come in a very advanced stage because there's no symptom in the early stages. The national program NPCTCS has a plan of implementation at the primary, secondary, and tertiary levels. And cytology-based screening programs are difficult to organize in India because of issues related to absence of trained manpower, infrastructure, logistics, quality assurance, frequency of screening, and cost involved. But we know Meenakshi Mission is doing a good job. But when we think about the community, it's so difficult to collect the samples from so many women. So we need so much of resources to do that. So cytology, so we have other methods also. Cytology, visual inspection with acetic acid, high-risk human papilloma virus screening, and sometimes we can also do combinations of cytology plus HPV. So these are basically the four types of screening methods for cervical cancer. So impact of Pap smear was that with well-structured organized screening programs, Iceland mortality declined by 80%, Finland mortality declined by 80%, Sweden by 50%, and in British Columbia, that was the country which showed a highest reduction. But in India here, you can see that the rates, though it reduced, but still it remains so high. So cytology has, the sensitivity is not very good, and there's sometimes a false reassurance even in high-grade disease, because if you don't know how to take a proper smear, sometimes a CS cervix, the report will also come out that there is no cancer at all. So we may lose the best opportunity of the diagnosis, which is the only and the one opportunity, and we have lost that opportunity. So to overcome all this, we had a better method called a liquid-based cytology, which literally means study of cells through a liquid media. LBC represents a major technological advancement in cervical cytology. Liquid-based preparations have largely replaced conventional Papanicolaou smear for cervical samples in the United States and in many other developed countries. So I think this is a boon for all gynecologists. So this is the speculum. We have a broom-like brush with endocervical. You can use endocervical brush along with that, but the long bristles can enter into the endocervical endocervix, and we move it at 360 degrees five times on the cervix. And ultimately, the brush is put into the container where here you can see on the slide, it's either a thin prep or a BD sure prep. So here you can see again, this is the bristles, brush with bristles, in which the long ones enter into the endocervical canal and the shorter ones are splayed over the ectocervix. And so we collect cells both from the endocervix and the ectocervix. So the thin prep sample collection. So here we put the brush into the container, which contains the liquid medium, and you can discard the brush. So the advantages of LBC is that it's simple to collect. You can do a pap smear, which has a very good clarity. And at the same time, you can do some other tests along with that, which is a P16, Ki67, when you are in doubt whether it's precancer or not. So this is a marker test for P16 and Ki67, or a dual test. And you can also do a HPV test in case you have some kind of asters or some kind of high-grade lesion. To triage it along with that, you can do a HPV test in the same sample. So these are the biggest advantages of LBC. So the success of cytology-based program then needs repeated tests at regular interval and wide coverage, which is not feasible in a country like India for community level services. So the Indian government, the government of India recommends screening method by government of India guidelines in 2016 is a VIA, visual inspection with acetic acid, from 30 to 65 years of age, done once in 5 years. So this is the government of India guideline, because it cannot do a community-based cytology program. So we have the sensitivity, studies have shown that the sensitivity is comparable to cytology. It's implementable in rural areas. So VIA test becomes a test of choice for a country like India in limited resources. So visual methods are via VILI, via VIA, via VIAM, which is a VIA with magnification. So VIA is visual inspection with acetic acid. So acetic acid is vinegar. We use a 5% acetic acid, 3 to 5% acetic acid, which has to be freshly prepared. So VIA is done with naked eye, also called cervicoscopy. Or VILI is also known as Schiller's test, in which we use leukocyanin. So what is the basis of this? Abnormal cells have increased nucleocytoplasmic ratio. So when we apply 3 to 5% acetic acid, the normal epithelium does not show these changes, but a VIA positive also seen in immature squamous metaplasia, inflamed or regenerative cervical epithelium, wherever there is a lot of nuclear material or nuclear proteins. So VIA, visual inspection with acetic acid, is a technique for the detection of precancerous of the or cancerous lesions of the cervix. The application of dilute acetic acid on such lesion triggers whitening of these lesions. So here you can see the picture. One is a VIA negative clearly, and the other is a VIA positive. So VIA positive is when we apply acetic acid, wait for 1 minute by the clock and see what is happening to the lesion, if there is any white lesion appearing. So for this, we need 5 ml of glacial acetic acid, which is diluted with 95 ml of distilled water, to prepare a 5% acetic acid, which has to be prepared afresh. So modified lithotomy position, inspect genitalia, insert a Cuscoz speculum, visualize the cervix. We need a really good light for that. Apply 5% acetic acid and wait for full 1 minute and observe using naked eyes only with a good light. So here you can see that we have to identify the squama columnar junction. The columnar epithelium is the red epithelium, and the pale pink epithelium is the squamous epithelium. So this is called the squama columnar junction. So the squama columnar junction gives rise to cancer, all of the cervical cancer, in 99% of the cases. So if you can identify this zone first and then apply acetic acid, any lesion abutting on this squama columnar junction is a suspicious lesion. So how do you interpret? It's either a VIA negative, VIA positive, or VIA positive of invasive cancer. Negative is no acetovite lesion, it could be a polyp, cervicitis, inflammation. VIA positive, it's a white, either it's opaque, dull, or oyster white, with sharp, distinct, and well-defined dense margins. It's usually inverted margins or is sometimes raised from the surface. And so that's a negative, positive, and you may also sometimes see some ulcerative cauliflower like growth, which is a frank cancer. So these are some pictures to show you that it's a no, here there is no acetovite lesion, and here it's a ectropion only, which is again VIA negative. So this is again a VIA negative lesion, which has really needs a little insight into what we are doing. And so you have to do it to actually confirm how much, what your expertise in that. So these are again VIA negative lesions. So VIA positive is here, you can see this is a dense acetovite area with feathery margins. And this is again a dense acetovite area on the upper lip of the ectocervix. So So we have a positive test result. So here you can see that it's quite a dense lesion and quite a big lesion, and this is extending into the endocervical canal. So this lesions, if you see without acetic acid, I think 100% you are going to miss it. So if you spend one more minute of applying acetic acid and looking at it in a good light, I think you'll pick up these lesions, and this could be called extended gynecological examination. So friends, please do not lose the habit of using a speculum, because we have become too tech savvy. We use always the TV scan. Whenever patient comes to us with any complaint, we do a TV scan. And for God's sake, such lesions will never be picked up by any TV scan. And by the time she comes back to you after 2-3 years, maybe she'll be harboring some frank cancer by then. So kindly do the speculum examination. If you have one more minute time in a woman more than 30 years, with white discharge, put acetic acid and look at the surface with a good light. So this is again a VIA positive lesion, in which you can see that these are huge multiple growths around the cervix, and this is again a frank cancer, in which here is the cancer and around that you have precancerous lesions also, which look white on adding acetic acid. So the sensitivity is around 50 to 88%, and the specificity is 66 to 89%. So VIA is the government of India has told that it should be done from 30 to 65 years. Is being done in 100 districts now. But the challenge is that it is very, very subjective. You should need facility for that. There is a risk of overtreatment. And in menopausal women, it is difficult because the spermocolumnar junction recedes into the endocervical canal. But the advantages are that it is very easy to do immediate. You can screen and treat in the same sitting. And we can also augment the results by using many types of smart scope which are available with artificial intelligence. But quality assurance has to be very, very important in VIA. So that is the issue. So artificial intelligence has again come up so that they to interpret these lesions, because it's very, very subjective. So again, it has been shown again in a study from India that many CIN3 lesions were missed because of the program failure. So for that, HPV DNA test was approved in 1999. So US FDA approved a high-risk HPV test as a primary screening tool for cervical cancer. So here you can see that the sensitivity of HPV DNA and the sensitivity of PAP are so different, while the specificity remaining quite almost the same. So the US FDA along with WHO in 2021 have really told that primary screening with HPV is going to be the answer. And the validated tests for primary screening have been so many of them. So when you are choosing a HPV test for primary cervical screening, you should know which are the tests which are validated, because many tests are now available in the market. So out of this, Abbott Real-Time, BD OnClarity, Cobas 4800, 6800 are all expert HPV, PapilloCheck. These are validated tests by the FDA. So, and coming to the self-collection method, which is the in thing now because of the pandemic, we don't want our women to come and crowd our hospitals. So if we have the self-collection, and that can very well be done by the same brush which I had shown you before. So it's quite practical. It gives a privacy and autonomy. It's best for the underserved populations. Sensitivity may be a little less than the physician collected sample, but it's comparable. And non-participation is a greater risk. So I think we should take into account this self-collection when the woman doesn't, it's not needed for the woman to come to the hospital and crowd. Only when she has a HPV positive result, then only we are going to call the woman to the hospital. So it's recommended in women above 30 years. Utility after 60 years is again doubtful. Can be used in younger women and postmenopausal women who have a cytology report of Ascus or more, and this is called a triaging. So if you have a HPV positive result, what are you going to do with that? Either you do a cytology and then follow up with treatment, you can do a genotyping and follow up, or do a VIA. So I think you can back it up with some kind of another treatment so that the false positive or the over treatments is completely reduced. And so the 2030 targets are that a vision, a world without cervical cancer. The goal is below 4 cases of cervical cancer per 100,000 woman years. So for this, we need by 2030, 90% of girls should be fully vaccinated with HPV vaccine by 15 years of age. 70% of women should be screened with an HPV test at 35 and 45 years of age, and all managed appropriately. Because again, just to remind all of you, the screening is not going to save lives. It's only treatment which will save lives. So screening has to be backed with treatment for us to reach at our goal, and then 30% reduction in mortality from cervical cancer, so that the cases which are detected also should get adequate treatment, maybe radiation or maybe surgery. So we have to tune our younger generation to get ready for this, because we are going to do a lot of screening in the coming years. So this is the WHO 2021 guidelines, which shows that, I'll just go through that fast, that HPV testing has to be done. So in a screen and treat approach, using HPV DNA detection as the primary screening test, WHO suggests treating women who test positive for HPV DNA among the general population of women. In a screen, try and treat approach, using HPV DNA detection as a primary test among the general population of women, WHO suggests using partial genotyping, colposcopy, VIA. So either you can screen and treat, or you can screen, try and treat. Everything can be done. So from India to the world, a better way to prevent cervical cancer. So this was a publication in the New England Journal of Medicine. We showed that a single HPV test that is performed 15 to 20 years after the median age of first sexual intercourse will detect many easily treatable persistent infections and precancers while limiting overtreatment. So this is again a conclusion that in a low-resource setting, a single round of HPV testing was associated with a significant reduction in the numbers of advanced cervical cancer and deaths from cervical cancer compared to VIA and cytology. So this is to show you that when we are doing only screening or only vaccination, the rate of fall of cervical cancer is like 13%, 21%, 29%, and 44% according to the age. But when we combine it with vaccination and screening together, the rates of falls are really significant and is going to make a difference. So thank you very much. So it's a three-pronged approach. We have to do a vaccination, we have to do a screening, whatever method is immaterial. So I think whatever is available to you, please do. So if you are available for the good resource setting, I think HPV test is the best test which you can do. And please take help of self-sampling also, because it doesn't make any difference in the results. So thank you very much, all of you, for this opportunity. Question to Dr. Madhusudanan. I just wanted to know whether you are doing conventional RBC, HPV, all the tests are being done in your lab?
We are doing LBC predominantly. We are continuing with the conventional also, because we are not able to get away from the conventional completely. Still,
yes,
there
that's the affair of everybody, yes.
As far as assays are concerned, there is not much request to do it by ourselves. So we are mostly outsourcing it for high-risk DNAs, HPV DNAs. So right now, that's the situation here. But we have a considerable load for liquid-based cytology. Almost like we are getting 15 cases every day. So that load is there. But still, when it comes to HPV DNA, the kind of awareness is still lagging.
Actually, so I think it's onus from all of us to do some awareness programs for the doctors, that the WHO guidelines have changed from cytology to HPV-based screening, because it's more specific and it's, I think, also simpler for the patient and for the doctor as well, because they can also do the self-sampling. But maybe as at this point of time, it may be a little costly, I understand. But when the demand for that goes up, like it did for the coronavirus testing, I think the rates will automatically go down. So I think we need to do some awareness programs about HPV testing for our gynecologist friends, so that they become aware. And maybe a public awareness program also, this public programs. So, and there's a question from Mr. Jayesh.
What is the current practice in India regarding screening by HPV DNA instead of cytology?
Yeah, thank you very much for that. But my problem is that there is no screening program, community-based screening program in India. So as of now, whatever is there, it's all opportunistic. All the women coming to the private clinics get themselves screened. And the women who are really need them, who are in the far outreach places, they really don't have any screening, and they come with very advanced cancer in the very late stages. So we are hanging between doing and not doing. So when we have an option of doing, I think anything is good, like a VIA or a cytology or HPV testing. So if you are, and that you can decide according to your resource setting, whatever is available to you. So according to the Government of India guidelines, still as of now it is visual inspection with acetic acid from 30 to 60 years of age. So if HPV testing is available, I think we should do it, and especially in high resource settings where it's available and women are able to afford it. And also, as along with that, I think vaccination has to be taken care of. So for the girls from starting from 9 years of age, so I think vaccination that has to be promoted along with the screening. So both have to go hand in hand. Thank you so much, Mr. Jayesh.
So any specific genotype of HPV that is associated with cervical cancer, and is this genotype covered in HPV vaccine?
Yes. Yeah. Obviously. So whenever a vaccine is being produced or manufactured or is being researched upon, always we take a backup data of what are the commonest causes of the cancer and what are the commonest genotypes which are causing the cancer. So as of now, going just back to the background, we have around 100 genotypes of HPV virus, and out of that, around 20 are carcinogenic. Not all are carcinogenic, because 6-11 are varieties which cause what, and out of the 20 are carcinogenic, and out of that 16 and 18 are responsible for around 70-80% of the cancers, followed by 33, 58, 45, so many are there. So now more recently we have a non-avalent vaccine which is covering 9 strains of this virus. Initially we had a quadrivalent which has 6, 11, 16, 18, and we had a bivalent for 16, 18, and more recently we have a non-avalent vaccine which is now going to be more and more effective for prevention of cervical cancer.
Good evening everybody, and nice academic what we have just witnessed. There were two topics basically, both were from the field of, actually we have scheduled it in such a way that everything should get at one place, from the gynecology point of view also, and from the obstetric point, what is being offered presently in for the aneuploidy screening. We can see the trend has changed for the both the things, the cervical cancer screening as well as the aneuploidy screening also. So we have to get updated as per the current trend. So that is why the topics were scheduled in such a way. So I'm thankful for Dr. Bhagyalakshmi for giving her time, for giving his wonderful and very expertise opinion regarding aneuploidy screening. I would like to add regarding one thing, that Meenakshi Lab is providing both the tests here, the cervical cancer screening in the conventional as well as the liquid-based cytology form. These tests are available in the main branch of the laboratory in the Meenakshi Labs Madurai, and the samples are collected from all over the 10 branches, whatever we have. We have 10 branches across South Tamil Nadu, and the samples will be collected in a proper containers and will be transported from our logistics team within a stipulated time, and the report will be released within a short turnaround time. So both the tests, as you can see, both the tests from both the fields, from the gynecology side and the obstetric side, both are the high-end tests that are available in Madurai, and you will not have to go for everything to Chennai or Bangalore or somewhere remote places. And this facility is available in Meenakshi Lab Madurai itself. So I'm thankful for all the participants, and I'm thankful again for both the speakers for sharing their views and their ideas and their expertise regarding this, both the two areas which are very promising, and they have upcoming trends in both the fields. So I'm thankful for the organizers of the management of the Meenakshi Lab for providing such a wonderful opportunity for learning from both the speakers. Thank you.